You may be seated. Good morning, IPC Hebron. Good morning to the visitors as well. We've been studying from this portion called the New and Living Way. And for what we are going to speak about today, I think we already had the Spirit lead us in that peculiar way with the songs that we were singing and what Pastor Alex was speaking from the Psalms. So the New and Living Way is our series. And we spoke about the new covenant. We spoke about the new birth, the new heart. And for the last 4 weeks, we've been studying from the new fruit, the new fruit. And specifically, we have gone through the fruits of the Spirit. And just to remind you that each person sitting here has a spirit, soul, and body. And the soul is composed of the mind, emotions, and the will. And today, we will talk about a crucified life where our heart is so filled and in every step guided by the Holy Spirit that we will show forth the fruit of the Spirit daily in our lives. So as we saw from Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23 is our main verse. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness. And today our topic will be faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such there is no law, which means you can practice it as much as you want. You want to be in the perfect will of God and get full of these fruit of the Spirit. Amen. In the King James Version, this particular verse says, faith, meekness, and temperance. Some of the words are used and we will study those together. If you look at the pomegranate that we have been studying, the first three were brought by Joe, Elder Joe here, about love, joy, and peace. And then the next three by Justin about patience, kindness, and goodness. And today our topic is about faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I put a little note there that even though, and we've been all saying this, these are not nine different fruits. It's not a plural fruits, but it's a nine-part fruit, which is a singular, and it's the different aspects of a crucified life. Different aspects of a crucified life. So by way of introduction, let me tell you about the story of a boy named Christian. Christian was a young boy who had a serious blood condition that was discovered in his early teen years. He was in dire situation because the blood dyscrasia condition had caused his bone marrow to be messed up, and he had to undergo a new bone marrow transplant at the age of 15 for his survival, or he would have died. Now, surprisingly, he had his blood retested a few years later when he was 19, 4 years later, and his life-saving bone marrow transplant, the donor marrow that had provided the bone marrow was what was found in his DNA. And his DNA, Chris had in his blood what was the donor DNA. It was mixed with his own DNA, but it was also the donor DNA that was present and not his own. When I was thinking about this, you see, it makes sense, really. The goal of the procedure was to replace the weakened blood of Christian and to replace it with the donor's healthy blood. So when you swab the cheeks, the lips, the tongue, it showed mixed in with Christian's DNA was the DNA of the donor. And so when I was thinking about this portion that we've been studying about a new fruit, this is kind of the experience that happens to someone who goes through this experience of becoming a new person in Christ. After receiving their salvation in Jesus, we are undergoing a spiritual transformation. As it says in Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, we become a new creation. And if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away and the new has come. It is up to us, though, whether we continue to take our rejection medications continue to follow in the path to keep our new bone marrow. If we do not do that, then it's possible that we have a rejection, a transplant rejection, and then you are ending up backsliding as well. Well, when we are talking about the three things we will talk about today, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, it talks about the content of someone who has become new in Christ, the conduct of a person that has become new in Christ. And as we go through these, let us examine ourselves to see if we are indeed having a crucified life. And from these three portions, we can see that in order to have a crucified life, we need to make ourselves small. In the society we live in today, with social media and Instagram pictures and TikTok and all of these things, the goal is to make yourself look like you're having a better time than you may actually be having, right? Show yourself off to others. But the crucified life of Christ is asking us to make ourselves small. The fruit of faithfulness, meekness, and self-control specifically goes into that. Remember, we started this four-part series by looking at the final I am statement of Jesus. Let me read that. John chapter 15, verse 1, 4, and 5, where Jesus said, "I am the true wine, and my Father is the husbandman. Abide in me, and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the wine, neither can you unless you abide in me." So the key to bearing fruit is to abide in Christ, and the sap of the Holy Spirit that is in the vine, and the Father, the husbandman, who takes care of all of this, would be showing forth as characteristics in our life, specifically with faithfulness, meekness, and self-control. So when we look at the word fruit, I'm not sure if we've defined this. In the original Greek, it's called karpos, which means an end product resulting, a result of something that is living. So it's a natural end product of a living thing, And so the fruit of the Spirit, when it's displayed in our lives, it is a sign that we are being led by the Holy Spirit, that we are connected to Christ as he is the true vine, and that we are taken care of by God, who is the husbandman. So it's time that we examine our lives, as we were talking about in the songs. Are we willing to say that, "Lord, let your will be done in our lives," or do we want our own will to take place? Sometimes when we say God's will be taking place in our lives, we do have to be made small, and are we willing to go through that? What is our karpos? What is our fruit in our life? Right before the fruit of the Spirit, we see that in the verses in chapter 5, 17 onwards, it talks about the sinful acts of the flesh. I won't necessarily read that here, but you can look at it and see where do we fit in with our fruit, our karpos. Now let's go into the three that we are to study today. Faithfulness. Faithfulness, the Greek word for it is pistis. Pistis. It's mentioned 67 times in the New King James Version. And in Latin, it's the word fides. Fides, like the word fidelity comes out of that. So faithfulness is to be persuaded of something, or to persuade someone of something. It is the core meaning of faith, divine persuasion received from God and never generated by man. As we've been saying the last many weeks, this is not something you can produce on your own. If you produce it on your own, it can last for a while. You will get burnt out and you will wither away. If you're not in the vine, you will wither away, and it's good for nothing but to be thrown out in the fire, is what we read in John 15. The synonyms could be somebody that is trustworthy, to be sure and of someone, and there's no doubt, or true could be the meaning. Well, I broke this up into two different things. Faithful, or faith, is what it says in King James, faith. Faith, or pistis, or fides, there's two relationships that we need to be faithful in. First is our vertical relationship with God. We need to be easily persuaded, believing, confiding, and trusting in the Lord Jesus. The only way that we could be saved is by the Spirit working in our lives. So there, if we are saved, we know that the Lord and the Spirit of the Lord was working in our life. We need to continually be trusting, easily persuaded, believing, confiding, and trusting in the Lord Jesus. Trusting that His promises are true in the Word of God. Believing that He is the sovereign God and that our eternal hope is in the Lord. That while we are living on this earth, that we try to emulate the qualities of Christ. Without a doubt, believe that Jesus came, died, and rose again, and that Jesus is the only Messiah, not one of the ways to get to God, but He is the only way, the truth, and the life, that He is the author of salvation. We need to be in a personal relationship with the Father, through the Son, with the help of the Holy Spirit. We can see those references in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. So the first relationship that we need to be faithful in is our vertical relationship with God. And then if we, you see the verses there, and if we are relationship vertical strong, then we see that our horizontal relationships will be right. Our horizontal relationships will be with everyone around us. Faithful in our transactions at work, in our family, and all around in our life. Worthy of trust so that others can rely upon us. Keeping the faith of others and sharing with others. Suffering willingly for the sake of the gospel. Being selfless, humble, having the attitude of Christ, as it says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 3 through 5. So we need to be faithful in our vertical relationship with the Lord, and we need to be faithful in our horizontal relationship with others. And that is what the Lord expects of us if we are abiding in Him, if we have the Holy Spirit guiding us each and every moment. And so we see the parable of the talents in Matthew chapter 25. We see a man going on a journey, and he called his servants and entrusted them with the money. One of them got 5 talents, and another got 2, and one only got 1, each according to their ability. So God knew their ability and gave them the appropriate talents. The 5 person doubled it to 10 talents. The 2 person doubled it to 4 talents. And they were said, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much and enter into the joy of the master." But the one who received 1, he said, "Master, I know you are a hard man. I was afraid that I would lose this." And he dug it into the ground, and he returned that 1 that the Lord gave him. He did not increase it. And we see that he is called, "You wicked and slothful servant, cast into the outer darkness." So we should examine ourselves as to where we stand in terms of the fruit, component of the fruit called faith or faithfulness. Are we faithful in our relationship with the Lord? Or are we letting other things come in the way of that relationship? Are we believing the Lord and His sovereignty, His strength over our life in each and every aspect? Or how are we doing with our relationship with others? The next part of the fruit that is talked about is gentleness or meekness. And in Hebrew, the word is anav, which means to kneel or bow down, to be humble or respectful. In Greek, the word is prates, which is known as meekness. And it is a divinely given virtue that can only operate in faith. Kindness, tender-hearted, mild-mannered could be other ways to put it. It is closely related to humility. You can think of it as the grace of the soul, as we were singing. In Philippians 4, verse 5, it says, "Let your meekness be known to all men, for the Lord is at hand." It is a behavior trait that we cannot try to create on our own, because we as human beings are in this fallen world and we have the tendencies of Adam. But once you're in Christ, you have the tendency of Christ, and you could be submissive and you could have a disposition to be patient and long-suffering, as we heard last week, respectful of others. I put down here in Numbers, we read that The meekest man on earth was Moses, and he had to go through a process to become meek. We know about his 40 years and 40 years before he had to go through go and become meek. If you look at Jesus, we see that he is also meek. And if that's the case, how about you? Are we meek in every one of our transactions? How about me? Am I meek in all of my transactions? See, sometimes when we think of the word meekness, we think it's weakness. If we look at the worldly standards, we think someone who is meek is like quiet and not able to speak up, and it is considered a weakness. But Jesus, would you call Jesus somebody who's weak? Or would you call Moses somebody who's weak? That's not necessarily true. Jesus had all of the powers of God by his side, and yet he chose to be meek. The meekest man on earth was Moses, but then God, the God-man, Jesus, was very meek as well. And so meekness is not a weakness, but it is power and strength under control. So that's a disposition that is even-tempered, tranquil, balanced in the spirit, unpretentious. It is to have your passions under control. In 1 Timothy, it says to pursue meekness in all that we do, and especially in correcting others. In 2 Timothy 2:4, it says being gentle, which is the other word for meekness. So a person who possesses these qualities will be bearing one another in love, as it says in Ephesians 4:2, pardoning other people's errors and slights, correcting others with gentleness and not quarreling with others, restoring a person gently in a spirit of gentleness. If ourself is what is jumping out and we are ready to be quarrelsome, we are ready to beat someone up, if we're ready to fight with our words or do anything else that is not godly, then we need to examine how is our fruit of the Spirit. How is our gentleness these days? There's many verses in the Bible that goes on to talk about gentleness and meekness. In Matthew 5:5, it says, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." And in Psalms 37:11, it says, "The meek shall inherit the earth." That's a whole sermon by itself and exactly the meaning of that. But it says, "They shall have abundant delight, and they shall have an abundance of peace." In Psalms 37:11, "The meek shall inherit the earth and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace." Don't we want the abundance of peace? And if that's the case, we need to be meek in our day-to-day dealings. The Lord Jesus himself said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest for your soul." Jesus himself says he is meek, and he is saying that if Jesus is meek, I want to be like Jesus. It is not a weakness trait, believe it or not, children of God. The world would like to tell you that being meek is a weakness trait, but no, the word of God says, Jesus said himself, "I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest, and you should follow and learn of me." Receive with meekness the implanted word in James, it says, which is able to save our souls. Without meekness, someone is not submissive to hear the word of God and come to the saving knowledge of Christ. So we need to have a meek heart to begin with for us to implant the word of God in our hearts, to be taught by the word of God. The meek, he will guide and teach his ways. So this is a character trait that most of us think we should not have. We want to be abrasive. We want to be fighting. We want to go and fight. But there are opportunities and places that we should do that. But at the same time, the Word of God says that there it needs to be meekness in every Christian. The next thing is self-control and temperance. Self-control and temperance. I believe that this was kept as the last of the nine parts of the fruits for a reason, because the crux of the matter, the climax of all nine of them, is included in self-control, or temperance is the other word, enkatria. In Greek, it means strong, having mastery, able to control one's thoughts and actions. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 5 through 7, it says, "True self-control is not about bringing ourselves under our own control, but being under the power of Christ. So really, it's a misnomer. It should really say Christ control rather than self-control. Because if we try to have self-control without the Holy Spirit, without our abilities, we are not able to do it. So it is something that is truly for a child of God that is God-given, just like all of these fruits. Last, but it's not the least. It binds all of them together. If we are willing to surrender and be in obedience to the self and to live for His will and purposes, we will see that self-control becomes a natural part of our life. So true self-control is a gift from God, and it is produced in us through the Holy Spirit. Ultimately, our controlling ourselves is a futile exercise unless we are being controlled by Christ. So it should really be called Christ control. And it is the last, but the most important one. And I like to explain why, because with self-control, what is it that is achieved? It is the last one that is said. And with temperance or self-control, we have the ability, with the help of God, to say no to the desires of our flesh. The desires of our flesh. Without self-control, we're not able to do that. And when we are able to say no to the desires of the flesh, we have and we show the fruit of the Spirit in every aspect of our life. And all the other fruits, the love, the joy, the peace, all of the other ones are amplified when we have self-control. Now, on the other hand, the Word of God says, if you don't have self-control, you're like a city, in Proverbs, where walls are broken through in a person who has lack of self-control. We don't have walls in our lives. We are succumbing to the works of the flesh that is mentioned right above it. And so if we continually succumb to the works of the flesh, if our walls are broken, then we will continue to go into those actions of the devil, and we become under the control of the devil. It's almost like taking not taking your rejection medicine, which is to study the Word of God daily, to have communion with Christ, but you are purposely saying yes to the things of the world and no to the things of God when you do not practice this Christian virtue of self-control. As the worship team is coming up, let me say that this is the most important one, as I would like to say it, but I'm sure each one is important. Without self-control, you cannot have some of the other things, and self-control would mean certain things practically in our life, right? Bearing this fruit, it is very important for every Christian, and that should be our goal, the glory of the Lord. As we were singing, being in the perfect will of God, in Psalms chapter 1, it says, blessed is the man that yields his fruit in his season. He is like a tree planted by the waters. He does not stand in the way of the sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. So there is some action, almost like the rejection meds that we have to take. We have to study the Word of God daily. We need to have a personal relationship with the Lord. We need to abide in Christ. Jesus proved this to us by showing His love and was obedient to God the Father and came from heaven, died on the cross, and He could have easily saved Himself, but He went through this for us. So He once and for all has taken all of our sins, all of our punishment. And when we abide in Christ, which means we love Him and we practice these things by willing obedience, by having self-control, by having meekness, by having faithfulness to Christ and being faithful in our actions to those around us, we show our total dependence on Christ. We live in a society where people want to be independent, but we need to be interdependent and have total dependence on Christ. Amen. It says, those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. And if we live by the Spirit, we need to keep in step with the Spirit. So, in conclusion, let me say that in order to have all of the fruits of the Spirit in our life, In order to have love, joy, peace, in order to have each one of those, we need to have Christ and the Spirit. We need to be hooked on to that vine, which is Christ, and we need to be taken care of by the Father, the husbandman, and let us be continuing to do that as we develop new fruits in our lives. And if that is the case, we will be like that Christian that I talked about earlier. When they take a blood sample for us, you know, they look at the blood, and you will see that it is really not the blood of Minu. It is also the blood of Jesus mixed in. When you take the sample from his cheeks, when you take a sample from any part of his body, his hands, his feet, his tongue, the hardest to control, will you see meekness? Would you see self-control? Would you see faithfulness to Christ and faithfulness to those around you? May God bless you all with these words. Amen. Hallelujah.